Okay, one last area here before we go into the schedule portion and that kind of pay applications is the import-export tab. This is where you're going to be communicating with RMS. You will notice there's a RMS and there's a QCS. If you hit the RMS button, that means you're communicating with us, the government. If you hit the QCS button, that means you're communicating with your remote sites that you set up, the standalones. Remember the chart from the beginning. If you have an entire server-based system, you will never click the QCS button. There's no reason for you to click that button. You only have to click the RMS button. If you're on a server and you're linked to this, everybody's linked into the same server. Okay? And like I said, that is the preferred method of operating this system, is having it that way. I understand some field off, some companies don't want that much control going to the office, and I understand that. That's why you have the remote access pieces. And if that's the case, the master site needs to be the field office, not the home office. Otherwise, home office is going to be very busy doing import-export with us. If you want to have good data exchange and keep data up to date, you need to import-export us at minimum once a day. At a minimum once a day, you should import-export with your government. So, on to that. Like I said there, RMS is the... RMS is communicating with the government. This box right here that says notes from the government, we can actually type little notes to you, or you can type notes to us that this is pay application this, or whatever it is. But you will also get keynotes or information from the system. If it tells you your CLINs are unbalanced, that means your schedule does not match the dollars assigned to your bidding schedule. If you look back in the original contract, when you turned in your bid, you turned in CLIN 0001 is equal to this value. 002 is equal to this value, and if your schedule does not match that, it's going to tell you your CLINs are unbalanced, and it will not export pay activities or schedule information to the government when it has an unbalanced CLIN. So that's one of the key things you got to take care of. And it'll tell you little notes and stuff in here of different things. Okay, QCS. So if you are using QCS and you have this set up as a server type system, you will not put a check mark in this box. This box says, will QCS be used for remote sites? Will you have a remote site set up basically? So if you are going to have a remote individual site set up, then you will have to put a check mark in that box. Once they have downloaded the software, they will give you the site ID just like you did to us, and then you will provide them the M2 number and send an export from QCS to QCS to set them up. That's how that works. The government has no control over how many sites and that kind of stuff you set up. The only thing we control is your master site the first time. We'll set that up for you and then you control it next time. So if you put a check mark in the box, what's going to happen is this other box is going to populate, and then here's all your abilities. Within it, you can do the master site, home office correspondence, site office correspondence, RFIs, insurance, payrolls, all of these different features. Now, this is also a new feature because most contractors were, they would assign daily reports out to the QC, and the project manager would keep the pay application portion. You see that up there? Progress payments, that kind of stuff. Well, guess what? The QC's putting the actual start and finish dates right on the activities. Well, so now the activity schedule is assigned to the QC. So if you import the SDEF and you didn't have that daily reports portion given to the whomever was doing the progress payment portion, it wouldn't populate any dates in your for your activity schedule. It wouldn't populate the early and late dates. Because it was like, well, I don't have permission to do that, so it's okay. So, you know, that was an issue. So what they have done is they basically forced you. You will not be able to import SDF to get all these to one site. So again, that's why it's even, we keep impressing upon you that setting up a server-based system is the best way to go. Absolutely. If you have one site ID, you don't have the confusion. Now obviously, you have the ability to sign it out to seven or eight different sites. That's all fine and dandy and wonderful if you want to manage that. We can only take import export from one site, so master site. So if you want to manage that mess, go ahead. But when the problems start happening and you call me, I'm going to say, you know where your first problem is? You got too many remote sites set up. Because you just, it's like playing roulette or something. I mean, you're just taking a chance if the darn thing You know, every time you import export, you're taking a chance of something less than up.
How many master sites can you have?
One.
Only one?
Only one. One master site, and that is the only site that communicates with RMS now.
Is that for job or
for project? For a project. Now, as a company, you know, maybe you bid your work out of this office in San Antonio, okay? You may have one project here, you may get a job in El Paso, you may get a job over Fort Polk, Louisiana, okay? You can have three separate master sites, being the master site on the field office of each of those locations. So, yeah. So, unless the headquarters of the company wants to be the master site of all of them, then they can all go to one spot. We have some companies decide to do that. They say, okay, we're going to have a dedicated person who makes sure QCS is up to date and does all imports and exports with the government. We've had companies that have their policy, and that's the way they chose to do it. I don't recommend that, but because typically the guys in the field know better when the import, export, and that kind of stuff than the home office does. So, anyway, whatever policies you want to set up. All right, so exports to the RMS FTP repository, I hit settings. That's one thing that you want to check off the bat. If you're not getting exports or not getting updates from us or something like that, the settings may be set to export to a file, which, like I said in the beginning, we don't do that. We can't use USB drives anymore. The government can't, so we sure can't use that option. In CDs, there's no reason to do it since we have a secure FTP site, unless you cannot get connectivity, which means at the, like Fort Polk, out the way sticks over there, sometimes they can't get any internet connection, and we will do a CD. It takes some extra effort. All right? Okay. One thing about that, you know, you just saw that screen, had all those permissions and all that kind of stuff. Once you give a permission away, you have read-only access to whatever you gave the permission to that machine for. If that machine crashes, you are almost like you're stuck because you can't get it back. That machine has to actually give the permission up to you. So it's be careful, I guess, is my caution statement here. If you give away permissions, you no longer have that permission. You can't just take it back. So and sometimes then we'll let master sites actually go steal permissions back. If you go steal permissions, you might lose daily reports. You may lose data that was input on that site. So just be careful to mess with that. Another good idea is to make sure that your system is performing backups. At least once a day, once a week, something like that. Back up your system in case the database dives or something like that. The RMS programmers can actually help you out and bring it back. You know, they can either bring it back up, or when you download the new version and get the new site ID, they can actually, you know, help you bring in that information so you don't have to let them off everything. Importing and exporting, if you want to fully use the system, you really should be importing and exporting daily with us in order to get the full use out of the system. Because if you do a transmittal today and you don't send me an export until Friday, guess what? We're not date stamping it until Friday. Because it's whatever we get last, either the hard copy or the electronic copy, that's when your date stamps start. So if you think your 14-day turnaround or 21-day turnaround on the submittal, when it starts, it's whatever the last one we get. So we got to have electronic and hard copy. So you got to make sure and send that stuff. All right? Here's the submittal import-export. We briefly touched on this earlier about the Excel template. You have the ability to pull an Excel template. Now, one thing you want to make sure, be careful of here. The first option here, which is the default, says overwrite existing submittals. So if you have done some submittals and submitted them to us, and then now your designer has finished up this register, and you're fixing to import this new one, you might want to select merge instead of overwrite, because all the submittals that you already submitted to the government just got lost whenever you told them to overwrite everything that was just there. So be careful with that when you import this feature right here for this register. Go ahead. Where you get that is under rmssupport.com. Under user guides, here's the Excel template for the submittal register right here. There's also, you will see, an SDEF.zip file. that has to do with your scheduling, how you set your schedules up, and that kind of stuff. And then also, there's perimeter activity coding structure, which is additional requirements that on how you build your schedule. And we're going to talk about those later, but there's some information in here that is good to... just additional information to read or good to utilize under RMS. So this Excel template, basically, like I said, if you use a template, you need to... You can't change column, you can't change widths and all that kind of stuff. So you want to download the template one time and you want to do all your updates and edits and all that stuff to it, building your submittal register or updating your submittal register. And then you want to go and download a fresh copy and you want to copy and paste into the fresh one. And then you want to save it as a CSV format and just import directly in. So it's that finicky that if a column gets a decimal point too big, it won't import. It's that finicky, so you don't want to make sure and follow the process. And it gives you all kinds of warnings and errors. So if you download this thing, it'll tell you, wait a minute, you know, you can't adjust anything. So this is what it looks like. the template, this is how it is. And of course, the Excel column down below. So you can be able to pick, you just basically put X's in the blocks down the line. Okay, the reporting feature of reports, QCS. You have administrative, finance, QA, QC, submittals, schedules, and closeouts. So we're going to go through these and just kind of, you know, give you a little information on each of these. Administrative, you can get a list of contractors, which you probably already have a better list than this will produce, but you can still get a list of contractors out of this. Here's your action items again. You can run it just based on the report instead of hitting that first tab. RFIs and correspondence listings, so a tracking mechanism under administrative. Under finances, activity summary by plan. This contractor's pay request worksheet, I highly recommend you running that every month, because what it does is goes on an activity by activity basis of what you're asking for payment on and tells you, it goes to the action item report and it marries that up with the activities you're asking for dollars on. And if you're having a problem, it's going to tell you insurance is not done for this sub, or these submittals aren't done for this sub, or this hasn't had a preparatory meeting, or whatever, and it flags on an activity by activity basis what the issue is. So that is definitely an important thing. Also, this claim history report, that one is very important as well, because the government never seems to get the mod signed at the same time and a consistent basis. So if we're like, we'll agree on percentages on the 25th, and lo and behold, we'll send you a mod on the 2nd of the next month, and you're over preparing your payout, and you try to import it into QCS, and it says your claims are unbalanced. What the heck are you talking about? How are my claims unbalanced? It's because we processed a mod. And we need to go turn that mod off. So all you do is go click claim history report. And you say, oh, there it is. They already have this mod. That was after we agreed on percentages. Therefore, Mr. Government, go turn it off. Let me get my payout done, and I'll add it to my schedule next month. Because it was after the agreement period. So, you know, you're going to have to work with us on that. Because for whatever reason, between the contractor signing it, the government signing it, that happens a lot. Down the line is QAQC. We've already talked about this several times. Here's your three-phase control worksheet. That's your preparatory sheet. Here's your schedule. You can actually, you know, pull schedule out and see when it's going to be happening. Deficiencies issued by the QAQC, or the you can have a combined list. Quality QC test, monthly exposure hours, and then a warranty item, of course. You can use all of those as an individual report. You can run reports on a monthly basis or whatever.